Yeah, even now, like he doesn't defend Medicare for all ever. He says that he'll be okay with us like waiting a couple years until we have it. So it's like he's not really in it for the fight. He's in it for the clout.
Sorry.
No, go ahead.
I'm saying that was a something me and Nico talked about earlier today, which is like there's this weird disconnect in new media and on the left of people who they like have this idea like, oh, we didn't get it this time, so we're gonna have to wait till the next election cycle, we're gonna have to wait till 2024, we're gonna wait 2028, we're gonna have to wait 10 years from now, 15 years from now. And then when the Justice Democrats have a majority in Congress and they have a majority in the Senate and they have elect a progressive president, then we'll fight for Medicare for all. Like, that is so out of touch with reality and what's actually happening right now, because it's an emergency right now. Like, we need single payer right now, and people are dying because they can't afford basic healthcare in this country. So the idea that, oh, we can just wait 10 years from now, like, people who can't afford their insulin next week can't afford to wait 10 years from now. They can't afford to wait till next week because they can't afford to pay for it. So it's like people's lives are on the line. And I feel like people in new media, especially more, I would say, out of touch, how does Richard Medhurst call them? The boutique left. Like, they are comfortable. So even though they can pay lip service to the policies and say, oh yeah, it sounds nice on paper, their lives aren't materially impacted of in whether or not we get the policy, but at the end of the day, they have healthcare. They may pay more for it without single payer, but they still have healthcare. So it's not like a life or death situation for them. And I think that there's a new era in new media of people who do get the urgency of these policies and why we need to have them now. And like channels like yours and the Convo Couch and Nico and Jimmy Dore, like I feel like they bring their urgency to the issues, and it's clear that we can't just wait around for electoral politics to solve these problems. Like, we actually, direct action is the only option we have left.
Yeah. So Ali Alexander says, oh, didn't you hear that Joe Biden said help is on the way? It's been on the way for like decades already. Like, it needs to be here now. You were just saying, like, people are dying. It's a pandemic. Like, the moment is tailor made to finally have it. And then people like Bernie Sanders, who ran on this, who we thought was like going to save us in 2016, isn't even fighting for it. One of the points that you bring up on your show that I think is a really important point is there's not enough of these people in independent media that are calling each other out. Like how they call out the corporate media and the mainstream media for bringing up like all these bullshit points. They need to be holding each other accountable. And there wasn't enough of that like 2 years ago where it was just you or Nico. Jimmy Dore used to be afraid to call out TYT. It's only recent in which he started calling them out and holding them accountable. So it must have felt really lonely, I guess, for you back then, like 2 years ago when you were calling out other independent media shows.
Yeah, it was, and that's such a like a weird like silent rule that everybody said that like, okay, we're all friends here, we're all buddies. So even though one of the main things that they do is media critique, because they see the importance of trying to correct the record, and when people are saying things that are just incredibly false and misleading, and the impact that can have on national discourse or on policy and politics, they see the importance of that when the corporate media is misleading people. But for some reason, they feel like, oh, when it's other people, when it's my friends and new media doing it, I don't need to do a whole segment laying out how all the eight different ways they're wrong and how they're misleading the audience or anything like that. And I feel like that's just from when I first noticed it, I knew it was a recipe for disaster. And sit like over the last few weeks, definitely it's been more clear than ever, but this is something that's been building for the last couple of months and the last couple of years, because they're just these huge defining issues for the left where we really should be on the same page, and they're just all these wildly different and contradictory points of view out there in new media. And I'm not saying that it's a bad thing that people disagree, but I think that we should acknowledge the disagreement, and I think that we should have a discussion about it, because it's just impossible for both people to be on opposing sides and both of them to be right. So if you're going to just say, oh, this is my point of view and that's their point of view, and I'm not going to correct it for the audience, okay, then there's just going to be a lot of people who hear say, for instance, like Cenk Uygur or Anna Kasparian or Sam Cedar, they hear their shitty arguments, and they're like, oh, that sounds good. But of course we shouldn't force a vote for Medicare for All, because something is bad for the movement. And when you don't correct bad ideas like that, it just floats, and then people pick it up and they take it on for themselves. So it's important to have the discussions, and somebody's right, so everybody make their case and let the audience decide who they think have made the best argument, rather than just ignore it and like, oh, well, we agree on the big picture, so let's not get into any of these details, no matter how important they are, as we've learned in the last couple of weeks and last couple of months.
Yeah, and these are people that have big platforms. Like, they're now like in the hundreds of thousands. I don't know how much they were like 2 years ago. I think they were still like over 100,000, a lot of them, like Kyle Kalinske, Sam Cedar, and like they wouldn't criticize each other. David Pakman, like they wouldn't criticize each other and hold each other accountable. And then, like you were saying, like their audience picks it up and then keeps, they have trust in these people, because they're like, oh, they're not mainstream media, so they're more genuine. So it's really dangerous, because then you have all these people that are led down the wrong path because they're taking misinformation from, you know, the people that they trust on YouTube that they think are more genuine than the mainstream media, which I would say like they are for the most part, but I mean, it doesn't mean that they can't genuinely be misled.
Yeah, like, and Russiagate, I mean, there's so many different issues where like the divide between what people were believing on the left, it should not have been as wide as it was. Like Russiagate, it was bullshit from the beginning. And the people who really latched onto it were people who had Trump derangement syndrome. And it was just like, anything that's Trump bad, I'm just going to talk about it nonstop 24/7. And like, it was so bad that like, I remember TYT, if they say they did like 10 segments for the day, they did do a show 5 days a week. I swear to God, like 8 segments would have been about Trump and Russiagate, and the other 2 segments were probably about Trump and something else. So it was like so overwhelming, and it was so dominant. And this was like the main focus of discussion in the country. And that was just like, there was, the way I saw it, it was the biggest propaganda campaign since the Iraq war in this country. Like, it was the scale of it, the amount of attention that it got from the media compared to all the other stories. And over the last 4 years, it's been nothing but huge stories every single day or every other day. So at the height of Russiagate, it was like for about 3 years, that was all they were talking about. So if you claim to be like TYT, the home of progressives or whatever the fuck they call themselves, like if you claim to be the home of progressives, but yet all the content, damn near all the content you're doing is just repeating talking points from the CIA and the national security apparatus and mainstream media. All right, so we're going to have a conversation about that. And you're doing it uncritically, and you're doing it in a way that is provoking more antagonistic actions toward a nuclear power. So it's like, there were so many downsides to it that, of course, we should have been having a robust conversation about it in new media. And there should have been dialogue between some of the more prominent hosts in new media about it, because for the reasons that I listed before, but also that was laying the groundwork for this crackdown on fake news and censorship that we're seeing right now. Mm-hmm. So all of this has been building. And if we had the conversation about it, if there was open dialogue about it, if like prominent people like Kyle Klinsky, he would do a segment, he would do multiple segments about how fucking batshit crazy Rachel Maddow and Joe Scarborough and everybody else in mainstream media looked covering Russiagate and hyperventilating over stories that were proven false time and time again. He would do endless stories about that. But that discussion wasn't had in new media. And I think it was important to have it in new media because it created that whole Russiagate scenario. It just created a bunch of different camps. And we're so deep in the rabbit hole that we can't even talk about how bad censorship was, how bad corporate censorship is, and trying to and how we've got to this place where it's so widely accepted because of this whole crackdown on fake news. We can't even have a discussion about that with some people on the left because they think that Russiagate wasn't fake news. They think that the real problem with the 2016 election was that the Russia hacked the DNC and they stole Hillary Clinton's email and they were doing fake news. They were spreading fake news and misinformation online. Like, they think that is a serious issue. And they think that's something that the government has to, and the corporate social media platforms have to do something to combat because they've been so indoctrinated and so like caught up in the Russiagate hysteria. So this whole thing has like evolved way farther than it should have. Because if they had this debate, if everybody said, "Cenk, you sound like a fucking idiot," from the beginning, instead of like giving him the benefit of the doubt, I'm like, "Oh, maybe he actually like no, Cenk, you sound like an idiot. And you're repeating CIA talking points." And you're repeating stories that are proven false. Like a lot of people in his audience would have seen that and like, oh wow, maybe that person has a point, and Cenk actually can't verify all the shit he's saying, and it's just pure conjecture and it's just made up. And maybe I shouldn't believe this Russiagate thing. So that's my tangent on this whole let's live and let live and not criticize anybody in new media. Like, part of the job is media critique, and that includes like the media space that we're in, left new media.
Yeah, and that was really, really well said. And I mean, it's been years, and people now, like, it's been ingrained in a lot of people's heads. And I remember Kyle would say that he doesn't want to debate like Ben Shapiro or like Steven Crowder because he says he's giving legitimacy to their crazy arguments. But then he would go on to debate Cenk Uygur as if like his Russiagate talking points are like legitimate and that it's like something worth debating about. And then he would be quiet and not criticize him on his show like he criticizes Rachel Maddow. That was really dangerous. I think that's something that we need to learn from going forward, to not like stay quiet and, you know, hold each other accountable when we're really wrong about certain issues.